20 years ago, David would have had to go get me from the door because I've been pacing, just hoping more people would show up. And after all these years, David, when it's 100 degrees every day and you can get out of Hobbs and Nose the mountain, boy, I understand. I understand. So we're at that point. School's getting ready to start. So everybody's getting in their last second trips and whatever they can. And I'm glad they can and just wanted to come back safely. So some of you will know this family, some may not. But last week, I know him as Rusty, but Russell Mercer, he passed away. He's younger than Darren. He's about Tyler's age. He's 27, 28 years old. It's Kay Winry's, one of her grandsons. And he used to come to Bel Air all the time as a youth. I saw him a few years ago, and he seemed to do pretty well. He got ill, and some things happened, and he passed away. So on Friday here at Bel Air, we're going to do that service at 4 o'clock. And then after the service, the church is going to have a dinner. So please get with Mom. She'll kind of set that up if you can be here for that. There will also be a viewing here about, I think, 3 o'clock. So if you see me running around, it's because I've got to go from work to here pretty quickly. And so if you're able to help, that would be wonderful. We'd love your help. And if you know the family, I encourage you to come to the service if you're able to. I just can't imagine losing a child. I really can't. So keep them in prayer. When I talked to Melissa, his mom, she obviously is in shock. And we would all be. So please keep them in your prayer. And if you can be here and you can help us, we'd appreciate it. Now this Wednesday, we're having church. So I don't want anybody to leave and say, Pastor, canceled Wednesday. No, not this Wednesday. Okay, it'll be the one after. But we'll cover that when we get to next Sunday. I'll remind you, it's in the bulletin. On Wednesday the 9th, we will have service that will allow you to go to the fair. There's a Christian group there. Is it
For King and Country.
You'll recognize some of the songs that we sing here sometimes. So you'll enjoy the concert. Darren and Paula got to go here in Lubbock, and you'll enjoy that. So if you're able to, just a reminder, it starts late. So don't do what I do every year and go at like 5 o'clock and eat funnel cakes and turkey legs and all that. By the time we get to the concert, I'm wiped out. I mean, my cholesterol is off the chart. You know, I can hardly breathe from all the fried Snickers and things that I ate. So if you're going to the concert, you might go a little later so you're not there so long. If you want to go ride all the rides, I'll pray for you. You have fun. All right, stand with us. We are having service though Wednesday night, as we always do. Lord, we thank you that we can be here this morning, Lord, and that we can just worship you, Lord. But I pray that whatever we're dealing with, that we just lay it down at your feet this morning. Lord, I pray that you allow your spirit to move in this place in a mighty way. As we sing these songs, Lord, that we sing them to you.
with Castile family, Lord. Lift them up. If they're lost, Lord, let's keep them in mind. Lord, we pray that each of us here know you, but if someone doesn't know you, if we pardon the sin, we pray that they'll step forward today. Lord, just continue to be with Sean as he brings our message. Just let it lift us up and touch our heart that we might do more for you, Lord, than what we've been doing. Lord, we just ask you to be at the offering that it should be sufficed, Lord. In Christ's name I pray. Amen.
Continue to worship as you bring your tithes and offerings.
Thank you.
Lord, I pray this morning that we would just take your word and listen to it and apply it in our lives where it matters and things that we need to change, the Lord will be willing to change for you. Lord, I thank you for each one that's here, and Lord, I just pray that it'll allow you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Told me that I had to preach fast today. She didn't say it that way, but she said it. And then, of course, my mother agreed with her. So if I preach for 2 hours, you know the two people that it's her fault, because, you know, it's hard to listen to your mother, even at 53 years old. It's hard for her to be bossed around. You notice I put it all on Mom, because I can't really get mad at Melinda. She dealt with all the great kids, so that right there puts her pretty high up.
Sainthood.
Sainthood, there we go. Well, I'm going to do something that I never do. It's a challenge for me as well, maybe you this morning. But I'm going to use some big words, okay? That doesn't mean I'm really smart, it just means I have a computer and I know how to look up big words. The reason that I'm using some of the wording today that I am is because I'm hearing it on news. I'm hearing it out there in the world. I'm hearing these words and it matters a lot. As we've been studying in Colossians, studied last week that how blessed we are to be free in Christ. People all over this world today, they may be slaves in some sort of form to someone, but if you're a Christian, you're a slave to no one. Through Christ, you're a slave to nothing. In the Colossian church, there was people who we call Gnostics, and the Gnostics believed that they had a direct line to God and no one else did. And so they created their own rules, and they came up with their own doctrine, and it was messing up the church. People were not knowing what was real and what was not real. They didn't know the truth from a lie. And so Paul was helping them out. He was trying to explain to them. So Paul says, there's some things that you need to avoid. I don't know about you, but I have learned more in my life from my failures and from others' failures than I have from my successes. The reason Darren went to the Olympic Training Center, they even applied, was because the year before, he tried out for the games for London, and he was the alternate. And what that means? It means you don't go. He missed the team by one spot. And I was trying to train him in Hobbs, but we didn't have the facilities that we needed to do that. And the Lord opened up that door, but Darren was driven, and he moved to Colorado Springs by himself as a blind guy, because he knew to get to the goal and to not have that failure again, he had to do something different. And he did something different. And now he has medals, and he was on TV just the other day. And God has really blessed him. But he got better from his failures. I know we all like to be on the mountaintop. truth is, we're not there very often. And when you get to the mountaintop, sometimes, like Karen and I did last week, or last Saturday, you don't know what to do. If you're ever driving with me, and I say, hey, I got this really cool shortcut, you probably ought to call 911 and say, this crazy man is taking me to a crazy place. It's my dad's fault. But my dad and I have been looking for the secret hunting or the secret fishing spot for our entire lives. And so Karen and I was up in the mountains Saturday before last, and I thought there was a good river on this road. Well, 2 hours later, we didn't see no river, but we got to the top of the mountain, and our GPS basically said, hey, stupid, you're lost. We didn't know where we were. We were 10,000 feet up in the air. I didn't want to be up on the mountaintop very long, because I'd already wasted 2 hours, and my fishing time was being quickly thrown away by my long up the mountain trip. In life, we do the same thing. We're always reaching for these goals and working towards things, and even in your spiritual life, you're trying to be closer to Christ in all that you do. But there's more things that you shouldn't do than things that you should do. And we see this in our text this morning. In Colossians chapter 2, verse 16, it says, therefore, do not let anyone judge you by what you eat or drink, or with regard to a religious festival, a new moon celebration, or a Sabbath day. These are a shadow of the things that were to come. The reality, however, is found in Christ. The first thing you need to avoid is legalism. I'm going to tell you, this is the easiest of the three big words you can hear this morning. Legalism. So what is legalism? It's making rules that other people can't follow. So these Gnostics, these people that were closer to God than everybody, so they said that you still have to follow the kosher law. You have to still follow the Old Testament. And a lot of people they're talking to at this point are Gentiles. They're not Jews. And they're saying you have to eat certain foods. And you have to celebrate certain holidays and certain worship times. I have a good friend who is Seventh-day Adventist. Good friend of mine. I work with her. And they meet on Sabbath. And the one thing her and I disagree on is about the fact that most churches meet on Sunday. The other day, she was pushing me over the edge on it, and I said, now we both believe the Bible is 100% accurate, right? Yes. And I pulled out this verse. It says, do not let anyone judge you by what you eat or drink, or in regards to the religious festivals, the worship times, the Sabbath. The bottom line is you can worship anywhere at any time. Got it? Now, I can't tell you through the years how many thousands of people said, well, Pastor, I can worship when I'm out on the lake. Well, you could, but you're probably not. Now, you may be praying like I do sometimes, Lord, I've been sitting here for an hour and haven't got a bite. Could you help me out a little bit, please? Help me out a little bit? Or, Lord, you know, I've been sitting out here in the cold waiting to shoot something. Could you just walk them right in front of me? I sure appreciate it. I'm not having a worship service out there. I could, but I don't. The Bible says that we're together, right? When you come to Wednesday night, we're gathering together. When you come on Sunday school or Sunday morning worship, we're gathering together. Where two or three more are gathered together, I'm there with them also, right? That's what Jesus said. We need to meet together. But we have to be careful that we don't make rules. And we talked about this last week. We talked about this on Wednesday. So for whatever reason, God has really put this in the forefront. Don't make rules that make you feel better. God's got everything you need in this book. He tells you what to do, what not to do. It's all in this book. We don't need to help them out. We don't need to add to the rules. We don't need to define how we're going to put the rules in place. We're going to follow what God says. And Paul says, hey, don't let people run you down and make you feel bad because you worship on a different day or because you eat and drink things that they don't necessarily think you should. Probably some of you healthy people, there's some healthy people in the room. I'm one of them, right? You can tell I'm very healthy. I'm on a seafood diet. I see food, I eat. That's pretty much where I'm at. Amen? That's a good diet to be on. Some of the things that there eats, you would have to be blind to eat. I'm telling you. And then he makes his poor wife eat it, and she's so sweet, she even says it tastes good. Who makes a radish soup? There.
Soup with guava juice.
With guava juice. Don't that sound really encouraging? Really good. I'm thinking more like when I went to his house, he grilled up some chicken, and he had like some real food there. You know, my daughter-in-law's, not just Paula, the food they like, my food that I eat likes their kind of food. If you just put lettuce on my plate, and some tomatoes and all that, you better give me a gallon of ranch dressing because I've got to wash that taste out of my mouth. Karen will always tell the grandkids when they look over and see what I mean, oh, that's people, that's so gross. Can't believe you ate that. And she says, hey, just if you don't like it, just be quiet, eat your food. You don't have to like it. Imagine if I made the rules around here. On Wednesday nights, let me tell you what you would have. You'd have a buffet and Jessica is really spoiled us. them cupcakes she made with that cream filling, oh man. If there would have been leftovers, I would have taken.
Or them cinnamon rolls.
I even stole my own son's cupcake, but he took it back. And I mean, she's been bringing sweets. And we always have sweets, and they're always good. But she's been bringing sweets. As far as I'm concerned, have the sweets and drinks, and we're good. We don't need all that other food. But what if I told you, you can't come to this church unless you eat chocolate pie at least once a week? Now you're thinking, he has lost his mind. You know, with Karen's surgery, we got rid of the cancer, praise God. No cancer, that's wonderful. But she found out she's diabetic. I've lost 5 pounds. I am not diabetic, and even if I am, I don't want to find out. I see what she has to eat versus what I get to eat. Just watching her eat all that healthy food and no breads and all the good stuff made me lose weight. If I made a rule that you have to eat sweets every time, now I put my wife in a bad situation. So she could either do something that's bad for her health or do what I tell her to do. This is what they were doing. They were saying, you're going to do this and this and this. They wanted to control every moment of your life. Let me tell you, it should be Christ who controls every moment of your life. Not somebody else. If you start hearing pastors make up rules that are in the Bible, I'm going to tell you, you're probably going to go somewhere else. Go somewhere else. And you go, wow, I can't believe you said that. If I say something that is not biblical, I expect you to let me know. You can ask people all in this room, been around here a long time, that if they say, hey, pastor, you said this, I'm not sure about that, and you get your Bible, and I get my Bible, and I see that I'm wrong, the next time I stand right here, I will tell everybody, hey, I said this last week, and someone who loved came to me and showed me, and I was wrong. Let's get it right. Everything you should be about is about Christ. That's what you should be about. Just because I say it doesn't make it true. You need to find out if I'm telling the truth. If you take your Bible and you match it up with what I say and it doesn't match, the Bible's not wrong. Shines. Legalism happens when people just listen and they just sit there and they just soak it all in, but they never check to see if it's right. Bel Air is not about being Baptist. We're about being Christ followers and followers of the Word of God exactly how it's written. If that's not you, then I pray the Lord convicts you that you change. You know, now we joke. My mom's been doing this forever, as long as I can remember. So Mom has her own Bible. Her little supplemental Bible. It's called the Book of Irene. Now, she will admit that she has to write it in pencil because the Book of Irene changes a lot. You know, like, sons can't say nothing mean to their moms. Or, you know, sons have to do exactly what their mother says. She makes all these rules. She changes them. It's in pencil. Now we laugh because we know it's not a real thing. But that's what people are doing when they change the word. Verse 18. Do not let anyone who delights in false humility and the worship of angels disqualify you. Such a person also goes into great detail about what they have seen. They are puffed up with idle notions by their unspiritual mind. They have lost connection with the head, from whom the whole body, supported and held together by its ligaments and sinews, grows as God causes it to grow. The second thing to avoid is mysticism. Now, just the sound of that word ought to catch your attention. They will tell you right now that the United States is the most religious country that we've ever been. I'm Christian. I didn't say Christian. I said religious. There are many, many, many churches in our nation right now that are worshiping trees and flowers and plants and the sun. Yeah, it still happens. I know you thought that was something that happened way back when, but it still happens. What the Gnostics were doing is the Gnostics said that you need to worship angels. They were worshiping angels. And they wanted to know everything about angels. And they spent their time finding out about that. And then they would go tell each other all of these visions and things that they saw and all these crazy things. And Paul's saying, that's not okay. That's not about Christ. You go, well, Pastor, the Bible says that in the end days, that the, I always forget, so help me out there. The young people will have visions, and the old people will have dreams. Got it right. Yeah. That doesn't mean that you're to be worshiping other things. And if the Lord gives you a vision or a dream, that's from the Lord. You go, wait, a Baptist preacher just said it happened. Hey, it's in the Bible, right? Amen? Gives a young man visions and the old man dreams. It's in there. It's in the Old and New Testament. What I'm saying is, the Bible says, don't study genealogies. Don't study things like how many angels can fit on the pen of the needle, the top of the needle, the head of the needle. Don't study things like that that don't matter. You know what the biggest complaint about churches is and pastors? Is that we're not relevant to what's going on. And so what has happened is pastors have went out there and they've changed the Word of God to make themselves relevant. No. God's Word is relevant in 2023, just like it was in year 23. God's word is relevant every single time. We may have to change our methods of spreading the word, but the message of God never changes. Never changes. You ought to do, and be careful. My student worker did a, we were searching for different kinds of plants. Because we're building the new Southern Heights, and they want to plant things that are not, they'd be great in San Antonio. They're not good for hops. They tried to sell me elm trees, David. I know places I could probably go dig an elm tree out of everybody's yard, and you would think before. And so he was searching, and I cannot tell you the name of the plant he found. I would never live it down for sure. But when he found it, he said it out loud, and I was like, hey, what are you doing? And I see him Googling it, and I'm going, stop. Do not Google that. Well, I was too late. And I proved to him he shouldn't Google it. We'll just put it this way. I signed an agreement that I won't have anything on my school computer that I'm not supposed to. And so I was awaiting a phone call all day. And we quickly got out of it. But if you want to see mysticism, that's the worship and of other things besides God. That is doing things on your own to feel spiritual. There are times in worship that the Lord really, I mean, really works on me. And there are times that I'm more emotional than other times. Emotions are okay. But if your spiritual life is built upon emotions and goosebumps and good feelings, you're going to have a difficult time because it's not always that way. There are times during worship that I am broken because the songs are just speaking to me and going, John, you got to pull it together. You got to get right. Last Sunday, for whatever reason, man, I mean, the Lord was dealing with me. I haven't felt like the worship has been like that for me in a long time. It was powerful. But if I build my life on emotions, I will fail. When I get home, let me tell you what I'm going to do. I'm going to eat a good lunch, and then I'm going to pass out of my chair. I never get done with Sunday stuff until at least midnight, if not 1 or 2. Just how busy I'm tired. Sundays are difficult for pastors. It wears us out. It's a busy day. People said, really? You don't go home and pray or up? Look, guys, I'm exhausted. But those songs that we sing will be in my head all week long. And every once in a while, someone on the praise team will have a song in their head all week long. They'll come up and say, hey, can we do this for the special? Can we do this? Don't try to figure out the magic code to God. The path to God is through the blood of Jesus Christ. You can go boldly to the throne of God because of Jesus. You go to Christ. If you're trying to work up some emotions in your life, that's not what God wants you to do. You ever watch actors and actresses? They can cry just like that, right? Because they have methods and ways to build up those emotions. Not all women, but a lot of women I know, if they want their way and they're not getting it, man, they know how to play on our emotions, don't they, guys? And you don't want to see them crying. You don't. All right, some of you guys are getting in trouble. Sorry, Kevin. Not trying to get you in trouble. But they do, right? My granddaughter, Casey, she gave her secret away. She wanted something, and she said to, I think it was Karen, but she said out loud, "Hey, if I want something from my daddy or my people, I just give them the puppy dog eyes, and it works every time." She's a little upset that her puppy dog eyes don't work on her Uncle T because he's blind. She's already admitted to that. And when she asked me for something that she's not supposed to have, I do like this, and she'll work really hard just to give her puppy dog eyes. She's also told me that it works on her pawpaw, my dad. Why? Because she's perfect. Just ask me. Do whatever she wants us to. She knows how to play on my emotions. She's six. She already knows how to do it. And those little grandsons that are 2 and 3, they work her over. My mom and Karen, they get whatever they want. They know how to play that game. That is not what spirituality is about. Don't generate all of that. Let God work in you. And if you feel sad and you break because of something in your life and you're crying, amen, great. If you're happy and joyful and you want to clap in the song to raise your hand, pray, do that. But don't come up with some formula of how you're going to make that happen. That's mysticism. It's mysticism. Verse 20. Since you died with Christ to the elemental spiritual forces of this world, why, as though you still belong to the world, do you submit to its rules? Do not handle, do not taste, do not touch. These rules, which have to do with things that are all destined to perish with use, are based on merely human commands and teachings. Such regulations indeed have an appearance of wisdom with their self-imposed worship, their false humility, and their harsh treatment of the body, but they lack any value in restraining sensual indulgence. Now, I'm not going to lie, I had to look up this word on the computer and listen to figure out how to say it. And I may say it wrong. The only way you'll know is if you know this word or you do the same thing I did. Avoid asceticism.
Asceticism.
That's right, too, by the way. Asceticism. You go, what in the world is that? So Paul brings it back to these people about being in Christ. He tells them, since you died in Christ, died with Christ, you have died to the world. You have died to the world. Asceticism is when you are making the rules of your religion and you want everybody else to do the same. You're trying to spread a false word. It's the practice of self-denial. You notice it talks about how they appear and the things they do. So you just deny yourself. You abuse your body. We hear about monks. You ever studied about monks? They're not allowed to talk. They take these vows of silence. They do all these things. If they misbehave, they beat themselves with rods and whips and different things, to punish themselves so that they look really, really religious. God doesn't want that. Jesus already paid the price on the cross. That's all the violence that is necessary. He's paid the price on the cross. And no matter how hard you try and how much you abuse yourself and beat yourself up, that is not what God wants. God doesn't need you to prove anything to him. God already knows that you're a sinner and that you need him for salvation. He already knows it. He knows what you've done wrong. He knows what you're going to do wrong tomorrow. He already knows that. So if you're punishing yourself to feel more holy, to feel more spiritual, stop. Jesus has already paid the price for that stuff. stop beating yourself up. Barbara, would you say that we talk at least three times a week?
About.
If you count text, and sometimes 10. I can't tell you how many times I'm ready to lose my temper at work. And all of a sudden, I just get this random text that says, Sean, I hope you're behaving. I hope everything's going good. I'm praying for you. And what that translates is, God just told me you're getting ready to do something stupid. And I'm going to remind you that you don't need to do that. If you knew how many times that happened, you would laugh. You would laugh. It's a good reminder. Ethan, my assistant, and I was talking about this the other day. Just about the time one of us was really ready to say something we shouldn't, the other one goes, no, let's not do that. And why? Because I want people to see Christ in me. I don't want them to see the world in me. I don't want them to see me doing the same things that the world does when I have conflict. Why? Because there are other people that look to me. I was so humbled this week. I was in a meeting. I've been in meetings a lot this week and next week. I was in a meeting with principals and all these, and I had to be in a secretary's meeting. I was in these meetings, and I was a little intimidated. You go, well, why would you? Because I'm in a meeting about principal stuff, and I don't know about principal stuff, and I don't want to know about principal stuff. But I had to be in the meeting. And so I had to present our work orders and air conditioning schedules and how we do that. And I was talking to them. And someone who, quite frankly, I thought hated my guts, popped up and said, now, get your schedules in early, and don't do what I do, wait until the last second, and call Sean and interrupt his dinner. Then she said, if you need anything, Sean is the go-to guy. I thought, really? It's thrown off a little bit. And different principles of people, administrators started saying all these really, really kind things. And someone said, Sean, you probably ought to say something else. And I just said, I'm so humbled, I don't know what to say. Because I don't see myself that way. I see myself as a guy that ain't getting it done. I see myself as a guy that doesn't have any self-control. I see myself as a guy who isn't getting it right. No, I struggle just like you. Anybody that thinks a pastor just sells through life and we're in 24-hour day prayer and all, I wish. We struggle too. Deacons struggle. They have all of these things going on. It's not easy, but you need to give yourself a break. If you're like me, give yourself a break. You know what God expects of you, do it. You know what God tells you to avoid, avoid it. Your goal is to lift up Jesus in everything you do, whether it's at your job, whether it's at Walmart, whether it's here or at school. God has given you talents and gifts to lift Jesus up. You go, we hear this a lot. Well, we got to hear it, folks. Even our city, we're seeing evil just invade our city. And all these stupid things that the world wants us to do, it's slowly creeping into homes. But the schools, I'm having to take training that says some things that I sure don't agree. It's all creeping in the house. Let me ask you. Are you serving Christ or are you playing games? You know, when I was 19, worship and youth pastor at a little bitty church in Albuquerque in the South Valley. If you don't know anything about the South Valley, I think he was one of the only white guys in that whole part of Albuquerque. Mountain View Baptist Church. My pianist was in her 80s. Best pianist I've ever had. She had arthritis so bad she could play three songs. And then I had to play her. The pastor's wife would play, but I didn't know the difference of her victory in Jesus and Amazing Grace. I was in this little bitty church. I had 12 little kids from one family. They're all abused. They had nothing. We started a children's choir. They sang at the big fancy Baptist church in Albuquerque. And my friends, people in the church, we went and we cleaned them up. They all had lice. We helped them bathe and get their hair cleaned. We got clothes for them. All of this. And then I had another group of kids come in. And I had 20 kids that I was ministering to. And then the next day I was out partying with all the McDonald's people that I lived with. I lived two lives, two different lives. I was playing church. I know how. I'm good at it. I've been in church since I was born. You can ask my parents. I've never missed a church service hardly in my entire life. I knew how to play the game, and I hit a spot in my life. When I was 20, and going into 21, I hit a spot in my life that I wanted to kill myself. You don't know how hard that's to say out loud unless you've said the same thing before. People go, how did you get there? I was not being who Christ called me to be. I was playing games and living like the world. I'm not asking you or telling you to be perfect, but if you're sitting here this morning and go, well, I'm saved, so it doesn't matter what I do, it matters. I have a friend, I've told you about it. It's hard for me to call him a friend because of what he did. 11 of us went to church every Sunday. One guy didn't. He wasn't saved. We all partied together. He didn't go to church because of the way we lived. He died in a motorcycle accident. My friend will spend eternity in hell because of me. It matters what you do. It matters how you live. People are watching you. I hear stories about people in this room. You go, I didn't even know that person knew me. Well, they do. It matters. You've got to be church. You've got to be the light. You've got to be God's chosen people out there lifting him up in everything you do. Oh, well, it's not that easy. Yeah, I know. When I was a kid, during the invitation, the pastor would always say, you know, if you have a decision to make to tell everybody about, do that. If you want to rededicate your life. And I thought about it one time when I was older and I became a pastor. 29 years old, and I asked Jim Laster, I said, Jim, if I really did what you said to rededicate my life to Jesus, I would have to come up every single Sunday. He laughed, and he said, the truth is, you'd have to come up every single day to the church and rededicate your life, because you do things in that day that you don't want to represent who you are. That doesn't represent Christ. Take care of business. And if you're in a room and you're not a Christian, look, we're not about a bunch of rules. We're about following Christ. On Friday, when I do the funeral, there will probably be people here that are not Christian. would tell them. Or if Ray was doing it, or Darren, or whoever was doing the service, one of the main things I would tell them is, you can make it through life with Christ in a lot better fashion than you can do on your own. You need Christ. The Bible says today is the day of salvation. Why today? I can't promise you tomorrow. I'm going to bury a 27-year-old man. 27. That's the age of my kids. I'll bury that with his mother, his father, his grandma sitting there. You don't know if you got one more day or not. You have no idea. You don't know if the person next to you has another day. When I heard the word cancer from the doctor, I lost. Why? Because we know how that usually ends, don't we? God's got us through all of that. But what if she wasn't here tomorrow? What if I'm not here tomorrow? What happens if something happens to the pastor? What's going to happen at Bel Air Baptist Church?
Brother Ray will step in and have his sermons.
That's right. Step up and continue serving God, right? We got people in here that can do everything I do. Probably better. Who's going to go visit those people that I visit? Maybe God puts them on your heart. We have to be the church. We live in a world of evil. Don't join in. It's not that if you can't beat them, join them. Jesus Christ has already defeated evil. He's already won the battle. You just follow him. What Jesus' name this morning is at a time of invitation. Come pray at the altar, you pray with me.